So I don't want to bother you with my personal story, but I think there are some lessons that I learn either from a clinical standpoint and also in a more general in division about the future development of this technology. So I will try to be brief and try to allow more time for some short videos. I know that majority are surgeons, are colleagues, and they're probably enjoying more to see some blood around than philosophy. So I don't want to make the history of robots, and so everybody knows that. But let me say personally that was immediately in 1999 interested in one general concept that, in my opinion, is one of the key points that are justification for the future developments. The main concept is how to overcome the human limits. Because everything is very simple. For centuries, we have been struggling with our limitation in doing surgery, as for all other human activities. In administration, in aviation, and every aspect of the human life, we have been struggling with limitations. So, and after being, we say in Italian, colpito sulla via di Damasco, that means struck by a lightning on the way of Damascus, this is the Bible, about minimal invasive surgery, the concept of minimizing the negative impact of surgery on the patient, and the final recovery will be smoother, better, and that was a winning concept, but was against the human limitations, because some of the most demanding and complex procedures were too difficult to be performed laparoscopically with the standard tools. So the basic concept that, in my opinion, was very charming to me was the way of overcoming my limitations. And I don't tell you the little story why I got started, but it was as a result of incidental exposure to some prototypes, some videos prototype, when I saw these little tiny arms that they were able to do suturing on coronary arteries, because the first application of the robot was designed for cardiac surgery. Immediately, I understood the potentialities. And when I came back to Italy, I immediately started, let's say, breaking balls of administrators and looking for some private donations, and contacted the little company that was in California at the time struggling with debts and on the edge of bankruptcy, because there was no customers around the world. And immediately, for me, it was a kind of a illumination, understanding that's the way. And behind this, there is a very simple philosophical principle. It's a kind of metaphoric and to interact with reality using virtuality. So the trick is really here. The secret and the revolution of robotics is exactly here. We are using a digital interaction, a world that doesn't exist but has no limitation, because it's the world of our dreams. Is the world of the computers, our ability of making more and more complex software. So the trick is that instead of dealing directly with the patient, we were interposing the computer and the technology. That is the trick of robotics. And for this aspect, it's not simply, as many of my colleagues are saying around, an improvement of laparoscopy. Is not simply an improvement, is a disruptive change. And this kind of vision, overcoming limitation, using the digital interface, is what is allowing the future of this field. There is no, we have to be very clear. We may be struggling with economical issues, with financial issues, with organization, with cultural resistance, a lot of cultural resistance. But one thing is very clear. We are right. Other people is wrong. There is no way back. That's is clear. So I don't want to, again, be... just this is, was one of my mentors for robotics. Nobody's speaking anymore about him, but my first, very first exposure was with him in Brussels. And I remember I did my first gallbladder on a cadaver and was in the basement of the Saint-Pierre Hospital. There was a lot of smell because cadaver, but immediately I felt in connection with the system, that this is my job. And when I came back to Italy, I got started. This is the photos of my initial hospital in Tuscany. And I had more hair, and they were gray. Now they are white, and much less. And the first paper, and I honestly worked a lot. I didn't publish much, and but in 2003, at least we put some data on the archives of surgery, and that was the first series of complex operation, and there are the first Whipples worldwide, the first esophagectomy, the first lung, the first hepatectomy, all these collection of cases are in that article and are dating back of 2000, 2001, 2002. I'm not very good in claiming my rights around the world, but everything is written in that article. And I was lucky also in 2007, I met Dr. Benedetti that I need to recognize in public, and I immediately understood that I was sharing the vision with him, and he recruited me at University of Illinois, where there was the possibility of developing a bigger project and combining research and clinical developments and founding labs. In reality, the first school was in Grosseto in 2003. And because immediately it was clear that there was a need of a change in the training systems. And I think this, the little school is still active in Grosseto. Now Dr. Bianchi and Dr. Corati are the director of that school, but I'm participating to some of the courses, and it was my dear sister that unfortunately died very early. So the lab is named after her. And I think I reviewed it with Ricardo that was organizing the courses, and I think we trained almost 800 surgeons in this little school. So 800 young surgeon attended courses and had some training at the Grosseto School. And the experience in Chicago, my chair in Chicago is after the Lloyd News was respected professor in University of Illinois, so I'm very proud of having my chair entitled to him. And we kept developing. I was very interested, and I confess that I'm criticized around the world because I'm doing too many different kind of operation. And people is saying to me, which kind of surgeon are you? Are you an HPB, but you are doing also lung, you're doing esophagus, you're doing colorectal, spleen, pancreas. Which kind of surgeon are you? Because mainly in the US, having such broad expertise and is not considered a positive. It seems negative that you are doing too many things in a bed. In reality, I had the fortune of learning from masters. At that time, general surgery was really the king of the specialty, and I learned how to do many different operations. And one of the goals that I had from the very beginning to see how robotics was fitting into different kind of specialties and operation. So I put efforts in trying to expand the indication in minimal invasive surgery in different kind of indications. Let me move forward because otherwise, few things about my experience. Some of the most interesting point and probably liver surgery was one of the first application. And I remember one of the reason Dr. Benedetti recruited me in Chicago is that because he was able to attend in probably 2005 or 2006 one of the first right hepatectomy. It was a clean operation. It was very well done. And so I think the liver is one of the most promising, interesting field. I will show others, maybe short clips, but the possibility of performing a nice, clean liver resection with very low morbidity and mortality. This is a series of probably now almost 200 cases with mortality zero and a very low bileak rate. And it means that the quality of surgery was excellent. So the Whipples, I think it was one of the most challenging at the beginning. Now, again, 160. I know that there are surgeons in China that after 3 years, they were able to do 500, 600 cases. Again, I'm doing not only Whipples. Maybe in the same week, I'm doing esophagectomy, a lung. So this is why. But it was a nice model because we were able to standardize some of the steps, and recently they have been published as a standardized steps for the Whipple. I will show some other example of that. I think there are better videos. Also, the lung can be done really super anatomical, and you can do fully endoscopic without doing thoracotomy. The dissection in the fessura can be extremely clean and precise. And in my opinion, the lung is one of the best indications because the trauma to the chest even more for an open thoracotomy than the trauma that you might have for a laparotomy. Let's move forward. How to say, summarize almost 20 years experience. Using the present prototypes and systems. So there are procedures that, in my opinion, that can be performed only in a minimal invasive way, only if you have the robot available. There is no question that if you have to do microsurgical work in a deep field, in a close endoscopic environment, there is only one way. This is the robot. There are procedures that are probably improved, but we are unable to have the demonstration that it translates into better clinical outcomes. And there are probably procedures that are not changed much. Even though my vision is that in the future all procedure will be done robotically, of course we have to be objective now, and there are financial issues and probably organizational issues. We cannot do every procedure, but in my vision, probably in the future, all elective procedure will be done in this way. So an example of a procedure that, in my opinion, can be done only if you have the robot available. This is a series that we publish on vascular surgery, probably 16 visceral aneurysms, like this one has been done recently, is a right artery, renal artery, and out of the aneurysm you have branches that are perfusing the, there is no way of doing angiographically. You cannot put a stent. So there are solutions, either you do a nephrectomy, that's I think is not the case, you can do auto transplant, you can remove the kidney, remove the on a bench, or the solution is the robot. You can do in situ, and you see there is a saphenous bypass that we prepared from the groin of the patient, and immediately with a 6-0 Gore-Tex, you can make a reconstruction. And you can complete in 30 minutes all the anastomosis. Here you declamp the first lower branch, the easiest. You do the easiest first, you declamp, so you have a perfusion of half of the kidney, and then you reopen it, and you do the other suture. And there is no impact of the kidney because in situ, the kidney is able to tolerate well, I think, some warm ischemia. And if you limit in 30, 40 minutes all the warm ischemia, you can save the kidney and you have a perfect reconstruction of the flow. And you can check with the fluorescence. Of course, it's better to leave the suture a little loose instead of taking the risk of being too tight with the push string effect. And you might add some stitches or proline after that. And then you can check with the fluorescent. There is an immediate reperfusion of the kidney. So I think if you have to do microsurgical work inside the abdomen, there is no question that the only way you can do this operation if you have the robot. Otherwise, laparoscopically, honestly, I know that there are here probably one of the best laparoscopic surgeons of the world. And can you do that? Probably you say you can do that. That's, I don't know that. He's a magician. And that's I don't think the average surgeon can do. I think a good surgeon, I wouldn't say the average surgeon, but a good surgeon can do with the robot. The kidney transplant, I had the fortune of cooperating with Dr. Benedetti, and we developed a program mainly in obese patient with a full robotic kidney transplant. And I don't want to spend time on that, but there are clinical benefits for obese patient. You might avoid the risk of infection that might impact on the final survival of the graft. And so even this operation, I think it's a complex combination, not only of suturing, but also combination of understanding well the 3D positioning of your suture, because if you get wrong and you might compromise the blood supply or having complication like thrombosis, if you just misjudge the angle of the vein reconstruction, you may have a little torsion. So I think laparoscopy with the bidimensional and also the skills of working on the iliac is another clear indication that you can do this operation with the robot, but probably laparoscopically, no. Biliary reconstruction, I will present in another session later our experience that has been published on Annals of Surgery on iatrogenic biliary injury. I think with the robot you can change not only the technical way you're making the reconstruction of this ugly, unfortunately, complication of laparoscopy, but you can change the timing of the reconstruction. That you can imagine one of the dogma of this situation is was wait, just wait. If you have a tiny duct that has been transected, divided, it's impossible to make a reconstruction. Drain the bile out with a percutaneous drain and wait few months, and then you can make the reconstruction. This was one of the dogma. I remember Pisa University, that don't touch, drain, and then you make the reconstruction in few months. Because it was too difficult to make tiny sutures in that fragile environment with inflammation. I think with the robot, really, you can do immediately, and you can make reconstruction. There are, I will present later, there are 15 cases done in any kind of lesions, very high in the ilum, Kasai procedures. They can be done nicely with perfect outcomes, minimizing probably also the negative consequence of these injuries. Let's move on, because there are too many videos, I think, here. So there are operations that can be performed better. And when you are dealing with massive hostile abdomens, multiple previous operations, impossible adhesions, that was a contraindication of laparoscopy. Even the access was sometimes dangerous or difficult. And with the robot, you can do very sophisticated dissection. You change the setting of your scope from down up. And then with the cold scissors, you can keep the perfect plane of dissection. And if a minor desoralization happens, you can immediately repair with 4-OPDS, and so you are minimizing the risk of that procedure. And sometimes also you have to rethink the overall step of the procedure. You can divide a complex operation. Let's say you have a Whipple and then you have a massive adhesion. You can think about having two steps. Think about a safe enterolysis first, and maybe the port setting is different, and then you have, when the enterolysis is completed, you can think about resetting the ports for the final target, instead of trying to compromise the ports that might, in some way, make more complicated, more complex, either steps of the procedure. I think there are some extreme example of this situation. So this, I think, is a clear improvement of laparoscopy. The dissection of the uncinate. We are here, very important laparoscopic surgeons, but there are uncinate process and uncinate process. You know, the anatomy can be completely different. Location of the cancer can be really challenging. Could be in the uncinate posterior to the SMV, and you may have inflammation of the pancreas or a combination of multiple factors, as in this case, that is a cancer of the uncinate process plus aberrant anatomy of the right completely replace hepatic artery. That is a challenging dissection to do laparoscopically. And you may have attraction, as in this case, you may have attraction. It's not really cancer infiltration, but it's an attraction of inflammatory reaction and a combination of well done hanging maneuver and finally dissection. You can clean up all the tissue that is in between the artery and the vein, and even oncologically, that kind of dissection can really be a very sophisticated, elegant, and precise, and not receiving any kind of criticism from the oncologist. I remember at the beginning laparoscopy was blamed because some of the tissue was remaining in between the artery and the vein. Unfortunately, we don't have much time. This is the hanging maneuver, so you can move the SMV on the right or on the left in order to expose better the artery underneath. And you see there are tiny branches from the aberrant right hepatic artery. This is probably 1 millimeter branch, and you can suture with a proline 6-0, and you can divide. And that kind of fine details are difficult to do laparoscopically. And the incident of this aberrant anatomy is not a minor one. It's up to 20% of cases they may have aberrant vascular anatomy. Let's move on, unfortunately. Spleen preservative pancreatectomy, I don't spend time on that. But even simple operation that we say category of operation basically are the same. I can't say honestly that all the gallbladder should be done robotically, but there is
generally one but. Time is nearly up.
1 minute?
One minute.
So there are too many different procedures that unfortunately I'm unable to show. But there are a nasty situation like this that if you're lucky to have the robot, you can do very difficult cholecystectomy can become a nightmare with desmoplastic reaction around the liver. So I will skip the other. And some of the innovative, and you can even develop a new operation. This is, let's try to summarize, is a spleno autotransplant. And it's a lesion, it's a gigantic lesion of the spleen, a very young patient. So we decided to make an attempt of preserving the spleen. So with the robot, one of the difficulties is to separate the spleen from the tail of the pancreas. So this is the spleen. So there is a perfect preparation of the vessels in the ilium of the spleen. And then the spleen is taken out, is repaired on a bench, is perfused, and then auto-transplanted in the same patient. I can move forward a little bit just to see in the bench, is repaired, and then we are making the reconstruction immediately in situ, and I skip I'm sorry for that. Or sort of management complication. This is why yesterday I saw a minor bleeding from a gastric artery. Doing the pancreas, you might have a situation like this. So that was simply a bipolar coagulation, and there was a bleeding. So not panic. If you are able to suture well, that was almost at the origin of the inferior pancreatic duodenal artery. And so you have a blurring of the scope, and but you have a situation that with some experience you can manage because you are able to suture perfectly. And the final was a perfect control of the situation. The blood loss was probably 50 cc. But laparoscopically, to have a lesion of an artery very close to the superior mesenteric artery might be difficult to do without endangering the safety of the SMA. So there are situations, even the management of the complication might be better. I skip some other slides, and I want to just conclude that there are, because the concept, we don't have any more limits. because the interaction is a digital interaction, new platforms are around the way. And this is the last one that University of Illinois have been fortunate to have probably the first wave of systems, and we will start our program soon with ESP. And I'm sure that probably we can develop a new procedure. We can imagine to have extraperitoneal access to some target like the pancreas, retroperitoneum. I think the platform is ready for innovative operations. I'm thinking about endoscopic resection of cancer. In Asia here, we have a big impact of early cancer. You can do endoluminal surgery with a sentinel node mapping with a single site, a perfect single site approach. I think the perspective is very high on this platform. And the future development, again, there are no limitations. Our limitations are ability of having imagination. It's not more our hands, our mind, is our ability of dreaming, probably something the computer cannot do. And this is typical of the human mind. Because we can dream, we can make mistakes, and we can dream, probably we can help the computer to develop more and to overcome our physical limitations, not our soul, our physical limitation. And I'm sure that surgery will be better and better in the future because of that. We need, in a very humble way, we need to accept this. In our future of becoming superhumans depends on our ability of being humble. Being humble, simple, accepting our limitation. If you are doing this humble step, we have an unlimited way of becoming better and better for our future. Thank you.